Hello everyone, Helen the Russian here, and we are now officially in a holiday season. Yay! Thanksgiving is coming up, and then before you know it, Christmas is gonna be here, and then the New Year's, and then for us Russians, I'm Russian Orthodox, so we have extended holiday season more so than the Westerners, because we celebrate our Christmas is actually January 7th. And then we celebrate what we call Old New Year on January 12th, which is New Year that fell on the old Russian calendar, which was a long time ago, but we still celebrate it. Anyhow, before I start on the topic of this video, which is holiday scams, something needs to be talked about. I know it doesn't sound particularly festive, but, you know, everybody should keep that in mind and protect themselves. But before we get to that subject, just so you all know, some of you may already know this, this November 11th, so last weekend, was actually quite a significant day and date. So apart from the fact that it's 11-11, which is usually very auspicious, this particular November 11 actually had another 11 attached to it from the, it's from the astrology perspective. Such a day happens just about once in a century, so very rare, and it basically, I'm not going to bore you with the details for those of you who are not particularly spiritual, but it doesn't matter, you don't have to be spiritual. This basically for everyone a brand new beginning. Literally, you can start fresh, brand new, not just a chapter, I mean, you can start a brand new book. I kid you not. And it's actually very positive. It's really nice. I know, you know, different people are different. Some of you may not feel positive at all. Something may be happening in your life, or something might be happening just prior to that date. It's okay. It doesn't matter. It's like almost like, I don't want to use that word, but almost like baptism. You come out absolutely clean, it's fresh, and it, again, may not feel like it straight away, but I promise you, it's definitely happening, and it's all in the mindset. It really is. It's you can manifest pretty much anything, but keep in mind, there should be stepping stone to achieving whatever your goal is. So saying, oh yeah, sure, I'm gonna manifest $1 million, I'm gonna think about having $1 million and it's just gonna happen. Well, if you don't have any foundation for that, no, it won't. No, you can't manifest that. Start small. If you don't have a lot of money now, start by saying, okay, I'm gonna really make sure I have enough money to cover all my bills for each month. I'm gonna take whatever steps necessary, maybe working extra, maybe doing extra jobs like driving Uber and Lyft, yes, you know, that definitely qualifies, or doing anything else, and to make sure I have it set aside well before the end of the month, meaning put that money in the bank. You know, you all of you know approximately how much money you need to pay your bills every month, so set it aside, and you'll be surprised. It, like I said, small steps. It'll give you a peace of mind, because every time you kind of think about it, you're like, oh yeah, I have my rent covered for the next month. I have all this money covered. It's in the bank. So, and like you start from that, and then the next goal should be, well, I should put away a little money into the savings and so on and so forth. And you may or may not get to $1 million, but you will get to a better state of prosperity than you are now. Anyhow, I digress a bit. So, and also, oh yes. Also, the 23rd, which, you know, Black Friday, as it happens this year, is a new moon, and it's a brand new beginnings. Again, in addition to that November 11 portal that we already experienced. So it really is a big deal. Make sure the night before, set your intentions and wishes clear. And I mean, formulate it very clearly. Don't just say things like, oh, you know, I want to be rich. And that means really nothing. Set practical goals. Say it out loud. You don't have to do any rituals if you feel like lighting a candle or whatnot. You can, but you know, that's not about it. Like I said, it's all, a lot of it really a state of mind. I am, among other things, I'm motivational life and wellness coach. And you know, there is more to it, and that's why I charge money for my consultations. But, and by the way, if anyone feels like it, do contact me. We can, if you're local, we can set up a consult. I charge anywhere between $60 to $200 per consultation, depending on the lengths and exactly what sort of consultation we're doing. But anyhow, so now let's keep this in mind. So positive thinking, setting clear goals, and then don't wait till New Year resolution. Like, don't do this. Do it now. Start now. Start today. And then you will enter New Year already halfway or whatever, on the way there. And I promise you, it'll make a huge difference. I think 2019 is going to be an amazing year for everyone. I genuinely believe it. I can feel it. And so let's do it. Let's start. Nothing comes for free. Like, I don't know if I ever showed. I have a saying on my wall. I'm going to see if I can show it on the screen. And hang on. Let me see. Can you see? No, probably not. But let me try. Okay. Oh, there we go. Yeah, you can see it now. Okay, so here we go. Can you see it? Nothing worth having was ever achieved without effort. And it's Teddy Roosevelt who said that. And the reason I have that stenciled on my wall is because I firmly believe that to be the case. And I'm a living proof. I lived long enough life to know that it definitely is true. Right, now back to the subject of this video. Talking about holiday scams. Unfortunately, holidays bring along a lot of people who want to get rich quick using oftentimes criminal methods and sometimes unsavory methods. So I want everybody to be safe. We'll start. So I listed them out so I don't forget any of them, but I'll start one by one. First of all, charity scams. And these days, with social media being what it is, a lot of them try to get you through social media, like Facebook, sometimes Instagram, it depends. So if you want to donate to the charity, honestly, like personally, I recommend donating to a local charity or to someone you actually know personally. So you know for a fact, it's not going to be a scam. However, if you're too lazy, and it happens, you know, you want to be good, you want to do something good, you want to donate, and you want just to click a button and do it. And again, you can still do it with local charities, but verify the charity. There is Better Business Bureau is one source that you can verify the charity from. But also there are other websites, so make sure you cross-check and double-check, especially for charities that the name, when you see them, it sounds very familiar, but then you go and do Google search and the charity is actually slightly different name. Well, that the one you saw originally might be a scam. Personally, I donate to causes that obviously we all do that close to my heart. You can't really help everyone everywhere. So I donate to either police causes or to doggies. Mainly, it's very simple because police protects us and doggies need our protection. So there we go. That's why I donate to this. But as far as doggies go, a friend of mine, I'll give her a little plug. She runs a non-profit and genuinely non-profit rescue. It's called Forgotten Friends. Yeah, there was a bit of a pun there, so Forgotten Friends. She is a dog groomer herself. I've known her for decades. Her husband is a police officer, and she does it. She runs that particular. It's a dog rescue and dog foster. So they take dogs in, they take care of them, and then they place them to the permanent families. She does it with her sister, and they quite literally do it out of their own money and whatever donations they can get. And Manda, that's her name, they live in Paramp, so they have quite large land surrounding their house, and that's where rescue is. They set it up for dogs, and they have some other animals in there. So they solely rely on donations, but apart from that, they just spend their own money on this. So that's good example. Like personally, I would definitely give to her specifically, as in like she has a groom shop that's actually on Blue Diamond. So normally I'll just go there. We have a bit of a chat, catch up, and then I'll give her some cash because I know exactly where it's going. They have a Facebook page. They constantly do adoption events, usually almost every Saturday from either PetSmart or Petco. So, good example. Doesn't have to be that. If you want to help them, by all means do, but doesn't have to be that. You can help whatever charity you like, but verify, verify, verify. Don't give your hard-earned money to some random scammer who's going to go on a shopping spree. It's not going to make you feel good. I know, you know, when you donate to charity, in part, yeah, you want to help them, but also you kind of want some good karma to come around, which is fine. Nothing wrong with that, but make sure you know who you're doing it to. The next one, and it's really popular one, it's the dating scams. Oh, brother. This time of year, especially this time of year and Valentine's, a lot of people feel pressured to be in a relationship around this time of the year. Maybe because they going to visit family and everybody's paired up in the family and they feel kind of left out, or maybe family is putting pressure on them. Again, it's the whole, the subject to a whole different video as to why you shouldn't do that. You should, yeah, I can explain, maybe I should do another video about it, but bottom line of it, dating scams. If you go online, and they usually start online, and you know there are a million sites for that, but basically the simplest rule is, if this is too good to be true, if it looks too good to be true, if it sounds too good to be true, it probably isn't true. Yeah? And so every time you see this gorgeous man or a woman, whomever online, who seem to want to get together really quick and expressing all this, feeling straight away, or you know, talking this and that, asking, definitely people who asking for money online before they even met you, no, absolutely not, don't listen. There are so many sob stories these people will give you. Oh, they'll start this conversation, this online relationship, and then usually very shortly into it, there would be something that befell them. They got in a car accident, their mother got in the hospital, they need this money, or they want to travel to you, but they don't have money. Can you send them this money? No. But even those who actually want to meet with you and they seem to be local, be very careful. Definitely meet, preferably in a broad daylight, in a very public place where there are lots of people. I'd say Starbucks, and a busy Starbucks at that, well, this time of the year they're all busy, is the best place to do it. Don't meet them in isolated areas. Don't meet them in some random parking lot that has no people around. Don't, because there have been cases, that was on the news, I think a couple of people got hurt, and those were guys. The women presented themselves as someone who wanted to date them, and then guys got to the meeting point, and there was a guy in the car in there putting the gun to their head saying, give me your money. At one point, one guy actually got kidnapped, I believe, so be very, very careful, but more to the point, don't put that pressure on yourself. You don't need to be partnered up. To be happy, to be fulfilled, genuinely start with yourself. I know it's hard work. I know, and it takes time, and a lot of people kind of go, no, well, if I just had this boyfriend or a girlfriend, it'll be all better. And then, you know, basically what you're saying is you're hoping that another person, whomever they are gonna make you happy. Well, I promise you, no one can make you anything. Only you can make yourself whatever it is you want to be or you want to do, right? Okay, so that's that. Now, another popular scam around this time of the year is work scams, because scammers realize a lot of people looking for extra cash. And so there would be random ads or even direct emails saying, you know, there is this opportunity, you've been selected and whatnot. And most popular of those is mystery shopping. Well, I'll give you a quick course on mystery shopping. Be very careful. For starters, mystery shopping companies generally, they don't randomly contact people. There are several of them. There are quite few that are very well known and reliable. I can tell you the names, but you can look up in the blog. So the best ones that I know of, Bestmark, A Closer Look, Amusement Advantage, and there are maybe a couple or three more. Those are legit mystery shopping companies. But I need to tell you how it all works. It's fairly lengthy process to get signed up, and in the state of Nevada, you have to get PILB license, Private investigators license, bureau license. That's right. You cannot do any mystery shops, despite the fact that these companies, they actually themselves located out of state, but it doesn't matter because you're shopping in Nevada. You're doing mystery shopping in Nevada. And that's something that happened in recent years. Didn't used to be that way. You have to get that PILB license and it takes time. You have to go fill out the application, get fingerprinted, get take your photo, submit the application, and then I think 3 weeks later, so think about the time frame. So it takes about 3 weeks for them to send you a temporary license if you pass the background check, which is why they take your fingerprints. You need to pass the background check. And then the actual license comes probably months or months and a half later. But you cannot do any shops unless you have the temporary license on file. And mystery shopping companies will ask for that. And not only that, usually to apply to those companies, it's a fairly lengthy application and prepare to write an essay. Because a lot of those shops, they are essay-like. So essay would be, say, your recent visit to a restaurant. They would want you to describe your experience. But they want that essay in your application before you even got accepted. So it's fairly lengthy process. It takes time and a bit of a money investment because that PILB license with fingerprints and photos will run you roughly $110. Now, some companies will reimburse you that money after you've done X number of shops for them. But in the meantime, so think time and think money. And also when you finally done all that, keep in mind that mystery shops, it's not something you can get rich off at all. These days, mystery shops pay anywhere between $8 to $15 on the average a shop. And yeah, you get free meals, you know, they reimburse you for the meal, but it's quite time consuming. It's not as simple as, you know, checking some things and sending the report. It, like I said, it's multi-page essay type reports that take, depending on how involved the shop is, it could take you between 25 minutes to 3 hours to complete. That's not counting the time that you actually were performing the shop, meaning driving to a location, doing whatever needs to be doing, either eating something or, you know, shopping for something and then coming back and then doing that. So while it's a good source of little extra income, and I mean little, and some maybe free food and free services occasionally, it's nothing you can rely upon, and it's definitely the way, in the time frame we are now, you won't be able to do it in time for Christmas, so be very careful with those. Now, there is another scam, very popular these days on Facebook, and that scam, honestly, as old as Christ, I'm gonna say, because when I was young, we had a different version of that. Sorry, my nose is itching. Different version of that scam. The one that we have going now called Secret Sister. And it's spread through Facebook. And what they tell you is, right, you know, there is this name on names. Ah, God, my nose. Names are on the list. So order a gift from, say, Amazon or whatever, like for $10, and send it to the person on the top of the list and put your name on the bottom, and it's gonna rotate. So you send this one gift, but you're gonna receive back 6 to 10 gifts. It is a scam. And also they want you to send that, to forward that message to all your friends and whatever, so more people participate. And they're saying, well, the more participants in there, the more gifts you're gonna get. It's a scam. Don't do it. And more to the point, it's actually illegal. So the problem with that is, like, ultimately some might say, well, I'll try it. Well, if I lose $10, it's not a big deal, but maybe I'll get this, you know, 6 to 10 gifts. Well, the problem is, if someone actually gets pissed off enough to go and file a formal complaint with the police, so they have to investigate, and your name is on that list, well, you, at the very least, you will be interviewed because you will be considered participant in the scam. And so instead of your nice Christmas gift, you're going to be subject of police interview, which my guess is you're not likely to enjoy. Unless, of course, your ultimate goal was to meet a hot cop and, you know, get it down with him. But, you know, there are better ways of doing it. So anyhow, it's a scam, don't do it. And when I said, when I was little, and I mean little, it used to be a chain letter type of thing. So you get this in the mail, And it had names on it, and it said, send a dollar, well, in my country, a ruble, doesn't matter, the same thing, send the actual dollar, like paper dollar, to the name, to the top name on the list, and then these other people will send you a dollar, so you're gonna end up with possibly, you know, anywhere between $10 to $100 just for sending this dollar. So that was the version of this scam when I was younger, but yeah, scam. Alright, the next thing is not necessarily a scam, but it's just a warning, especially for the ladies. Generally, especially around this time of the year, be very careful with your bags, purses, wallets, and your expensive smartphones. And what I mean by that for the ladies, if you are shopping anywhere, including the grocery store, don't just put your handbag on the top part of the cart and leave it there while you're reaching for items or looking at something, because the crooks, they actually very skilled. It'll take them split second to walk by and flick your wallet out of that bag, and honestly, you wouldn't even know until you get to the register and you realize your wallet is gone. Same when you're unloading groceries into your car. Make sure, my recommendation, again, especially this time of the year, get a crossbody bag. You all know what a crossbody bag is, with the long handle. Put it literally across your body and always have it in front of you. In front of you. In the crowded spaces like a mall, same thing. I definitely don't recommend those. They became popular in a recent decade or so. It's women's handbags, but they kind of like a backpack. So you wear it behind. No. Really bad idea. I don't recommend it. And it's not, even if it's tightly locked and closed and whatnot, a lot of those pickpockets, they're very skilled. And what they do, they cut your bag a pocket. And they often don't even use the knife. What they do, they take a coin, they sharpen one edge of it, like really sharp, so it can cut. They have it between their fingers, and it literally takes them quick slit, and they flick the wallet out. And if that backpack is behind you, you're not even gonna know. You may not know for the next half an hour or whatever, and they're long gone, and you can't really, you can file a police report technically, but surely you're not expecting any result from that, because there is absolutely nothing to go on with this. Same with the men. Don't keep your wallets in your back pocket, especially in the crowded places. And it's not just malls and shops. It's also, this is the time for a lot of parties and gatherings. Definitely keep things, like for the men, keep it either in your front pocket or maybe in your jacket pocket, which is not as a good place. And I'll tell you in a minute, there is another scam that goes along with it. So same with your expensive smartphones. Don't put it in your back pocket. You think, oh, I can feel it. I'll feel when someone takes it out. Here, let me tell you how crooks work. A lot of them work in groups of two or more. And so one person or two people will distract you while the other one is working. So say, for instance, it's a bit crowded. Someone bumps into you with their drink or whatnot. They spill it all over you. They go, oh, I'm really sorry. And then they try to wipe. They go, oh, this and that. And you obviously very consumed with what's going on up front, while the person in the back is took your wallet, took your phone, and you didn't even realize. Which is why I recommend being careful with guys putting their wallet in their inside breast pocket of the jacket. Because some of those people, in Russia, I'm trying to think what's the proper English word for it. In Russia, we call them vyshibala. They literally kick the thing out of you, meaning they bump into you and they act like they either know you. They go, oh, hey, Dave, man, that's been years. And they, all this time, they pat you on the chest, except they're not patting. They're trying to get that wallet out of that inside breast pocket. And they're very skilled. Like, when I talk about it, you go, oh, surely I will realize, these people know what they're doing. You won't. So that's why I said that not necessarily the inside breast pocket is not the best thing to do. So anyhow, and people who go even to a very nice parties, like don't think clubs, think like really proper Christmas parties. Some of those crooks, they well skilled, they do go, they basically crash really well off charity dinners or Christmas parties, and they dress accordingly. They dress the part, They know how to get in, because some of it, yes, a lot of it by invitation, but it depends on how tight the invitations are checked. And then, of course, remember, there is in the hotels and everywhere else, there are kitchens and employee entrances. Like, I worked in many hotels, and I can tell you, good example would be Paris Hotel. I can get into a lot of places through the Paris employee entrances, because I know where they all are, and none of them have security guards. So I can walk in and I'll be inside the property, coming from the employee entrance into whatever, into the ballroom, into, so not through the front door, and I'll be part of the crowd and it'll go from there. And these people know those crooks, they that's their specialty. They do those events, same thing. They're gonna pickpocket, a lot of times they're gonna target the jewelry, because they know how to remove your jewelry without you even realizing. They're gonna look for your bags, ladies. So again, my best advice, honestly, is a bag with a long strap. So even if it's a clutch, a lot of them do have a long strap, utilize the strap. And the way I do it, I put it around my shoulder, on my shoulder, and I just, at all times, I kind of gently have my hand on it and keep it in front of me, meaning at no point I flick it back and it's hanging somewhere. Well, you know what? I'm lying. There was only one time, and I have to be honest, one time, this September, I went to the Best of the Badge, which is police charity gala. That particular event was attended by 1,200 people, of which at least half were police officers of various rank. And yeah, that was the only time I felt safe. I had the small bag with a long strap and I just let it hang. I wasn't paying attention. Well, that's, you know, for obvious reasons. I felt very safe in there. I knew no one's going to pickpocket me in there. So, but apart from that, kind of keep your hand on the bag and keep it in front of you. I don't really recommend clutches that don't have handles, because they occupy your hand. And so you tend to put them down really quickly. And even if you think it's within your reach or within your sight, all it takes is someone saying, here, you put it in here, and someone starts talking to you and you have a drink in your hand and you took your eyes away. And it's gonna take that split second for them to swipe the bag. That's it, your bag's gone. And in a crowded environment like that, you will never know who did it. So anyhow, that's it. That's my tips for you to stay safe. Please take care of yourself this holiday season. Don't let crooks spoil it. Just be vigilant and be alert, right? So everybody, enjoy yourselves.